Welcome to Reality Create a Video. I'm Hermes, or Tom. Today we're going to cover a start to finish on platinum, but using the plasma arc instead of low voltage DC. Now, if you've used my low voltage DC method of platinum, you'll know that it's long, involves chemicals, raising pH, lowering pH, and the yield is not that high. Well, plasma arc is much simpler in that respect. You put it in the beaker, you turn on the process, and 20 minutes later, you got a 20 parts per million platinum solution. Cook it for 40 minutes, you'll have a 40 parts per million platinum solution. Now, there are two transformers that I use. There's a 10,000 volt electronic transformer, and there's a 15,000 volt coil transformer. I've already done a video on both of these transformers, so I will link in the description section there, and you can review that later. But if you're just starting out with colloidals, with plasma arc colloidals, I would definitely go with the 10,000 volt square wave transformer to begin with. It's safer, it's cheaper. If you really want to get into plasma arc, or you not just want to do it just to cook the platinum, then you can go drop the big giant money for the big heavy transformer, which will be just be a little bit more efficient than the 10,000 volt one. So, but either one will work. Will create a plasma arc. The big problem with creating a plasma arc is everything has to be perfect with the water. And that starts with, believe it or not, soap. This is Dirty Labs dishwashing soap. I use this to clean my beakers. It has no scent in it whatsoever. Very important, because when you use scented soap on your beakers, it leaves behind the scent. And believe it or not, those molecules, even if they're really small, will interfere with your plasma arc process. Your beaker has to be perfectly clean. And after every plasma arc, I will wash this out with the Dirty Labs dishwashing soap, scentless, and make sure it's perfectly clean inside and out. That's the start. The other thing is you want to have distilled water. Preferably distilled water that you have done yourself. But you can also use store-bought distilled water. So water quality is really important. I mean, I've tried RO water, which comes in at 8 parts per million. It doesn't work with plasma arc. You will not be able to get a plasma arc. So it must be distilled water. The next thing I want to talk about is critical. And that is how to position the wires. Now, if you're new to my channel, you may not have seen my tops that I create, but there are plenty of videos on them. Roughly, this is a beaker top. This is a version 6.1 beaker top, and it uses eyedroppers, a glass in here, mounted here. I will leave a link to my where I talk about the 6.1 beaker tops in the description if you want to know more about them. Basically, the purpose of this is these eyedropper ends is to position the very tiny 24 gauge platinum wire so that we can get a plasma arc. The gap between the wire is important. It's dependent on whether you're using a 10,000 volt transformer or the 15,000 volt transformer, how wide that gap is going to be. And the wires have to be held tightly in place and positioned properly. That makes plasma arc real easy. Before I had the tops, it was really difficult to create a plasma arc with just some glass tubes taped in place. And so those of you starting out, I don't know what to tell you. You can take glass tubes, put them in, and kind of attach them to the sides here with tape and finagle it that way. If you have access to a 3D printer, either you all have a printer or you can get access to a printer, you can print up my tops. You can get the 6.1 top blueprint is available on the printer. You can print up all the parts you need to create this top, which will fit on a 600 milliliter beaker to help it make it easier for you to create your plasma arc. So I'll leave that bit up to you on how you want to decide to do that. The next thing you're going to need that I didn't cover yet is a magnetic stirrer. This is going to be very important. You have to keep that water going. And on bubbles inside your, you know, some of you people make silver, you'll put the air tube in there and have bubbles going. That's not going to be good enough. It's not going to mix the water fast enough, and you're going to get spots in the water where there's a higher concentration of colloidal than other spots, and that's going to cause your arc to get a little smaller and larger and maybe even go out on you. So this stirrer this is not a heated stirrer. It's just a regular stirrer. That's all I use for this. My expensive heated stirrer I do not use for plasma arc. I certainly could, but, 15,000 volts, why keep the very expensive $300 stirrer near something like that when, you know, why fry it if I don't have to? So that's why this very cheap, you know, I think it was a $20 stirrer with no heat works fine. But the only colloidal that you need to heat is gold. If you want to create rose plasma gold instead of the purple gold, then that you can throw the beaker in the microwave, preheat the water, and then put it on the stirrer. So make sure you pick up one of these stirrers, and if it doesn't come with the little stir, I got one over here. If it doesn't come with the little stir thing, that magnetic stirrer that sits on the bottom, you will need to pick up a pack of these things as well. The next thing I need to cover is safety. Very important. We are dealing with 10,000 volts or 15,000 volts. It's critical that you are careful that you do not get a shock or burned worse. So, I highly recommend these gloves. I'll put the link in the description for these gloves. These are rubberized gloves. They've got rubber ends on the end and nylon on the top. They're good enough for what we're going to be using. Anytime you've got plasma arc going, you want to use the rubber gloves. And you also want very dark sunglasses. You've seen me with my glasses. You don't want to stare at that plasma arc with your naked eye. Over time, you will definitely burn a hole in your retina. So, and let me tell you, that plasma arc is extremely compelling. You want to stare at it. It's like draws you in. Not to mention, you need to watch the plasma arc to make sure that it's healthy from time to time. So, very important, glasses and gloves. Do not forget these two things when you're doing with plasma arc. And only take these things off when your power is disconnected and your wires are disconnected, then take the gloves off and then you'll be okay. Now that brings me to one other thing, and that is turning thing. Oh, it's also part of safety. That is turning off and on the plasma arc. I use a Deadman switch. I'll show you a picture of my Deadman switch. It sits there on the floor here. I use a two switch thing. I have an arming switch over here, and I have the Deadman switch on the floor. So I will put the switch on the on thing, which sends power to the Deadman switch, and then the Deadman switch will send power to the transformer, whichever one I'm using, which will either be the 10,000 volt or the 15,000 volt transformer. But power will not be applied unless I press that Deadman switch down. And that is another safety feature. Because if something happens while you're doing the plasma arc, you can take your foot off of the thing and everything stops. So please make sure you have some sort of Deadman switch going on in your plasma arc setup. One final precaution before we begin. That is, power off your expensive equipment that is going to be nearby here. And make sure you don't keep your cell phone near the apparatus at all. Now, I can't even film plasma arc with the regular video cam that I use to shoot these videos. The noise from the static and the wave, the pressure wave that it creates, will distorts it. It doesn't affect the phone camera, ideally. So I will shoot video when the plasma arc videos that you see, I've shot with my phone camera. And I usually shoot it from quite a distance away, kind of like this, and I use the zoom on it. I do not want to get this phone anywhere close to anything else. I also turn off my equipment here. The video microscope, I shut that down, and I keep this off. I keep my power supply off. Definitely, you don't want to keep any sensitive electronic equipment close to the plasma arc. Got my gloves on because we are dealing with the wires. I've filled up the beaker with 500 milliliters of fluid. You don't want to use too much fluid. You want to use just enough to cover maybe a half inch or less of the wire. The more wire you got in the solution, the higher you're going to raise the conductivity of the solution and the less chance you're going to have a plasma arc. You could have it just sitting underneath the water. As long as it's in the water, keep it in the water. And that's fine. So here, I'll show you a close-up picture of what I got here. I got the two wires that I've pushed in here, and these clamps are holding them at the height that I need. And you also have to make sure that the two wires are perpendicular to each other. You might have to get in here with your finger and bend the wires so that they are absolutely close to each other, as close as you want. Now the gap you're going to have to play around with. It depends on the transformer you're using and the size of your wire. But you need some kind of a gap there in order to create the plasma arc. If you press on the pedal and nothing happens, play with your gap a little bit. Move it in and out a little. You might have to move it out. You might have to move it in. One important safety tip I want to add here. While you're doing the plasma arc and you're positioning your wires, sometimes you'll have to reposition your wires because the plasma arc will go out and you'll need to get in here. Please never, ever, ever touch these wires while they are energized with power. Take your foot off the foot pedal switch, the Deadman switch, reposition your wires, and then press the Deadman switch down. If you need to reposition the wires again, lift up the Deadman switch, reposition the wires, and keep doing that and get into a habit of doing it that way. You do not want to touch these wires, even with the gloves on, you do not want to touch these wires while the power is energized. Now I have a timer here that I use. Generally, with my setup, I will cook this for 20 minutes. It will turn into a light brownish color or almond color. It doesn't really get any darker than that. Usually takes, like I said, about 20 minutes, and that's where I'll stop the process. I put it in the video microscope to see if I've reached my 20 parts per million, and then I will just end the process there. It's usually about 2 milligrams of material off of the platinum that it uses, and that is really efficient. And how do you know when you're done making your colloidals? Basically, you want to bring your plasma arc colloidals to about 20 parts per million. Some colloidals you can cook further than that. Some you can't. The conductivity in the solution goes up the more colloidals that you dump in there. And as the conductivity of the solution goes up, the spark goes down. The spark is created because there's high resistance between the two wires. The water enables a very high resistance, and you have a high potential on both sides of these wires, and it creates the plasma arc to create the connection. That's how the plasma arc is created. But as you get more and more materials in there, the plasma arc diminishes. The conductivity, the voltage starts coming down, and the conductivity goes up, and eventually you'll get to reach a point where there will be no more arcing possible in the fluid. Not so with platinum. Platinum seems pretty good. You can cook that pretty far. But still, you only want to cook it till 20 parts per million. Now, how do you know? You want to monitor the progress as you're going along, right? So what I use is the lasers. I have a green laser that I use, but you can also use a red laser. The green laser is more powerful. So you got to take your trusty dark sunglasses. This water is still distilled water. I haven't applied any power to it. This is colloidal platinum at 20 parts per million, which I've already cooked. And we're going to put the laser beam first through the distilled water. And as you see, a very faint green line is here. If I put the laser beam through the water I've already cooked, you could see a very nice, well-defined green laser wire showing that this is absolutely full of colloidals. The red laser isn't as strong, but it still will show. And here you'll see no, very little trace of a laser beam at all in distilled water. And in here you'll see a very fat sort of dispersal of the particles this way. So whatever laser you want to use, that's fine. I will put the link to the description of the lasers in the description. And that's the same laser I use for my laser microscope. So it gets dual purpose here, if you want. And that's how you tell the strength of the colloidal. And finally, this is a picture of 20 parts per million platinum colloidal that we cooked up right there. I will put the video over here as well so you can see it. And that completes the start to finish on cooking plasma arc platinum. I hope you've learned something from it. Be very careful if you are going to embark on this sort of plasma arc colloidal, and follow all of the safety procedures that I've put out here. Now, you reached the end of this video. You've earned yourself another cool. And I want to thank all of you for visiting my website. Please subscribe, recommend my website to others, and have a great day.